What's going on, everybody? How are you? My name is Michael Levan. Thank you so much for joining me today. And what we're going to talk about is kind of a new topic. And that topic is infrastructure as software. Now, I know you're thinking maybe you've heard the term infrastructure as code at this point. So what is this whole like infrastructure as software thing? Well, I believe that, and a lot of other people believe because they're inventing not only companies around it, but products. So, you know, obviously a lot of people are driving forward with this. So infrastructure as software, what does this mean? Well, the first thing is that when you think of writing code, when you think of infrastructure code, you know, cloud development, maybe you could put it into that category. Essentially, you know, any single time that you have to create any type of infrastructure or any type of service in the cloud. So maybe you're thinking about Azure Kubernetes services, which is a service, or maybe you're thinking about virtual machines, which could be considered your infrastructure or your network or your storage, any type of compute. And then you have different services, you know, like I said, AKS, or you have serverless stuff like Azure Functions, bunch of different stuff. So how do you define this? We kind of like went through a few phases. And the first phase was, well, of course, doing it manually. The second phase was some SDKs. So, you know, SDK is a software development kit. And what that allows you to do is it essentially allows you to take some code in a general purpose programming language, and it allows you to interact with, say, AWS or Azure with a programming language at the SDK level, which that SDK hits an API, the application program interface. Then we kind of like started to see a little bit of those coming where, you know, a very popular one in AWS, for example, is Boto3, and Boto3 is a Python SDK to interact with AWS. And Azure has the same thing as well. And there's for different languages, you know, you got C Sharp, you got TypeScript, Node.js, PowerShell, Go, Python, a whole bunch of different languages that you can do this with. And, but here was the problem with that. The problem was that you weren't able to store your state. Now, what your state is, your infrastructure state or your service state, essentially just the metadata around what it's supposed to look like. Now, you can think of a state like just essentially like the metadata and the resources, everything that's defined for what the application or the infrastructure or the service is supposed to look like. So for example, let's say you're spinning up a virtual machine and you're giving it 8 gigs of RAM and 100 gig hard drive and, I don't know, 4 virtual CPUs, and you're connecting, you know, some virtual network to it or some network to it. That is considered your state. That is the state of the application. So the problem was with, you know, that first time around where we saw the SDKs for AWS and Azure, a whole bunch of different things, GCP and plenty of other applications, or I'm sorry, platforms, not applications, plenty of other platforms we've seen this for. So that was the big problem. The problem was the state. So then we started to see tools like Ansible, like Terraform, a whole bunch of other things, Chef, CF Engine, like a whole bunch of different tools to do this thing called infrastructure as code. And we were doing infrastructure as code with things like CF Engine before, you know, infrastructure as code was even coined. Now, what we're starting to see is we're starting to see that people still want to define services, you know, like AKS or like Azure Functions or anything like that, but they want to do it with general purpose programming languages. Now, when I say general purpose programming languages, what I mean is Python, Node, Go, C Sharp, TypeScript, all of that stuff. So that's a general purpose programming language. And what we're seeing is that like people want to use those. And there's a few reasons why. I'm going to list off a few primary ones in my opinion. The first is, I mean, of course, like you have different type of logic in a general purpose programming language. So you can do a bunch of if statements, you can do for loops, you can do general logic that you can't do in some of these other, you know, infrastructure as code languages. The second thing is testing. So you have unit tests, you have integration tests, you have mock tests, you have a whole bunch of different things that you can do from a testing perspective, and you can get very granular. Now, you can test infrastructure as code. For example, if you want to test Terraform, there's a framework called TerraTest. It's very, very good. But again, it's not the same as if you're just testing, you know, general languages. And the third biggest thing, I think, again, this is all from my opinion, just what I'm seeing, is a simple fact that, like, let's say you have, I don't know, a developer and he wants to do some infrastructure as code. He doesn't want to go out and learn HCL, or he or she doesn't want to go out and learn HCL or do a bunch of YAML or a bunch of JSON. They just want to, like, take the language that they're writing with anyways and create some services with it. And that's really where infrastructure as software comes into play, because what it does is it allows you to store that state and it allows you to do a general purpose programming language. So let's go over, like, a few different examples. We're going to go from using the SDK to infrastructure as code to infrastructure as software. Let's jump right in. So the first thing we see here is this is a way to create an AMI inside of AWS using Boto 3, which is the SDK to interact with AWS at the API level. So we can see here, this is just some general Python. So one, you have a function, you're defining three arguments or parameters, the image description, the instance ID, and the image name. And then you have some try accept blocks. And then in the try block, you're initiating the EC2 client. And then you're using the method for create image, and you're giving it the description, instance ID, name, and no reboot. You have an accept block here that it essentially goes through and just checks for some warnings and things like that. And then you're passing in some arguments at runtime. This is that sys.argv. You're passing in the image description, instance ID, an image name at runtime, and then you're checking to see if you're running this script or program as the main, and then if you're not, you have just a little else statement saying, you know, you're running it as an imported module, for example. So this is how you would interact with AWS at the SDK level. So now let's take a look at the next phase, which is infrastructure as code. So for example, we have a Terraform configuration here that goes through and it creates a storage account. So you specify your provider, you specify the resource that you're creating, and then you pass in those parameters for name, resource group, location, account tier, account application type, and then you also give it some tags. So now this is something called Pulumi, and Pulumi is very, very focused on this infrastructure as software method, where you take a programming language, TypeScript, Go, Python, whatever, and you create your services, your cloud services with it. So this is a Pulumi project. And if I go into the YAML, for example, now this is all auto-generated. So you have, you know, what the name is, the runtime, the description, any type of requirements. So for example, I'm using Python for this. So it's gonna specify, you know, what requirements you need at runtime. So now let's actually look at the code, the main file. As you can see, this is like a very, very basic example, but it's just Python code. There's nothing to it. There's no difference. You have an import here that you're using. So from Pulumi Azure, you're importing container service and core for the library. From that, you're using the Kubernetes cluster function or method. And then you're passing in all of the arguments, things like resource name and default node pool, the min count, max count, DNS prefix, what's the resource group this cluster is going to reside in. So as you can see, it's kind of like the same, you know, it's kind of the same as when we were creating from the SDK level, except now we have an actual state. We have that state configuration when we're writing our, you know, any service with our general purpose programming language. So with that, that's just a little bit of what I think the direction of everybody is going in. I don't think we're going to see things like Terraform and infrastructure as code tools just die tomorrow, but I definitely see this as being the future. And, you know, there's, you know, AWS CDK, there's HashiCorp CDK, like HashiCorp even created a CDK. And when I say CDK, it's the same thing. It's just like infrastructure software where you have a general purpose programming language that you're using to define your infrastructure. So even the creators of HashiCorp are kind of seeing this as, you know, at least another option. And with that, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it, and we'll see you again next time.